Welcome to our Bach Factory, this time on Cantata 215, Preise dein Glücke, gesegnetes Sachsen. Praise now thy blessings, O fortunate Saxony. Dear Rudy, welcome to our factory. It is a very long so-called secular cantata, which is not the church cantata, we'll go back to that later on. It's a very long cantata, and I would like to challenge you and to ask you to give us an overview of the musical content of this very long piece, just in a few minutes.
I'll immediately start. Listen to the roaring beginning. Trumpets, flutes, oboes, strings. Perhaps you remember, Hosanna, Hosanna. Afterwards, Bach used this choir. A long, beautiful choir with two choirs. And then it goes on with a recitative, with two oboes and a basso continuo. This music is like incense. Like this. They say, great August, great king. Listen to the beginning. Wie können wir großmächtigster August? Then comes an aria. It's always the tenor here. Freilich trotzt Augustus Name. And doesn't it sound very Italian? With a syncopation. That was the tenor. Then comes the bass. He starts. Was hat dich sonst Sarmatien bewogen, dass du vor deinen Königsthron dem sächsischen Piast des großen August würdigen Sohn hast allen anderen fürgezogen. Very serious, very earnest. And then afterwards comes this text, rase nur verwegner Schwarm in dein eigenes Eingeweide, roaring like a Ferrari into your own stomach. A real fighting music. Listen, it sounds like Vivaldi. And the bass goes, rase nur verwegner Schwarm. Modern music, and it sounds like Italy. After that, soft flutes. It reminds a bit of the Matthew Passion, where you've also got wood instruments playing a beautiful motif, and it's the soprano singing. Ja, ja, Gott ist uns noch mit seiner Hilfe nah. God is very near and will help us in all what is happening here in the political scenery. Xoán will afterwards explain that to you. Then comes music, perhaps you've already heard it. Two flutes, a little bass, not a cello, not a thorough bass, not a double bass, but violini e violetta. And the soprano sings, durch tiefe Neife entflammten Waffen. We'll be talking about this aria afterwards. Then all three soloists together, first the tenor, then the bass, then the soprano, and then even three together. And here you've got a marvelous moment when the bass singer does this here.
Zu einer Zeit, da alles uns blitzt und kracht.
That's lightning, that's thunder, then the trumpets and the timpani come in. And the strings. So you see, it's a real opera. Bach At the end of this recitative, he has a beautiful little terzet with this theme. Himmel, lass dem Neid zu trotze, Himmel. It sounds a bit like a slow Italian concerto. And to end, this long cantata goes more than 30 minutes. You've got the whole orchestra and the choir doing... What is the text? Stifter der Reiche, Beherrscher der Krone, baue den Thron, den Augustus besitzt. Which would say that person who sees that things are possible, that August can be a good king for the Saxony, the people in Saxony, that's God. Stifter der Reiche. And so you see, don't know how many minutes it took. I did my best. Now, Xoán, the revenge is sweet. Also for you, a few minutes. You were talking with Anselm, I think, and he told you a lot about this, and you studied the cantata. It's a complicated situation.
Yes, indeed, Rudy, I talked to Anselm, and those of you who will be watching out what happens on Bachipedia will also watch the introductory workshop that Anselm, our dear historian and musicologist, gave together with Rudy on the day of the performance of this cantata. So, as you could hear, it's a very long cantata, complex cantata, and it's all about Augustus. Who was this king? Well, he and his wife came to Leipzig in October 1734, and of course the whole people of Leipzig wanted to honor him and to show how much they admire him, their king. He was the king of Poland, and Bach wrote for his family already several pieces of honoring, of congratulation, what we call in German Huldigungsmusik. Augustus was the son of the strong king, Augustus the Strong. He was probably not as strong as his father, but he was a lover of music. He was a supporter of the arts. And of course, Bach, with this piece, created something very special to honor his personality.
Thanks, Xoán. That was really fine. I think now will be time to have a bit of music. Ladies and gentlemen, let's listen to an excerpt of the first choir, the first double choir. And I'm sure if you know the B minor mass, you will recognize it's a parody on the Hosanna.
The opening choir of today's cantata, Preise dein Glücke, gesegnetes Sachsen. Now we move on to the two next movements, number two and number three. These are a recitative and an aria sung by the tenor. Two important ideas come now when we regard the text, namely the idea we mentioned already in the beginning of Augustus being a big king, being a sort of father of the entire country. This idea comes now in the text, and also a reference to his own father, Augustus the Strong, the mighty father. So it is indeed a paternal hand, what we have here, and Augustus is depicted also as somebody descending from the gods. So, Rudy, we are now in the aria already when we talk about Augustus being a descendant from the gods. What's going on in there?
If you listen to the piece, perhaps you remember my quotation. I think if I would have heard that music, ladies and gentlemen, I wouldn't have recognized that as Bach. It reminds me just more of the modern composers in Dresden, where, of course, August was the king, and they had Italian composers there. Hasse, perhaps, Pergolesi, with these syncopations. You see, accents not on the puff, like a military music, but it's very elegant.
And also, in a way, very operatic. It's a drama per musica, that's also part of the subtitle of the cantata, and this is, I think, exactly what we hear, a very virtuosic aria full of coloraturas. Shall we have a listen? Sneak peek into the tenor aria?
Great idea.
Very good.
Tremendous bravura aria for our Daniel. Number four and number five is bass singer. You remember the Ferrari roaring around into your own stomach, a very incredible picture with this Vivaldian temperament. And in the recitative, perhaps you could explain a few very interesting words, Sarmatian, the Piast, and of course August, Xoán.
Yes. So we are always going back to this idea related to August, who was this man. Sarmatian is, of course, a legendary way of referring to ancient Poland and Russia too. So this is, as Anselm Hartinger also says, a kind of constructed identity, the way that people like to think of themselves being, you know, descendants of a mythic origin. And this Piast is also a similar idea. He is supposed to be a mythical peasant who founded the tradition and the dynasty, a dynasty that was extinct down in the 14th century. But, of course, Augustus is a descendant of this dynasty, but he is also a descendant of a kind of golden age. Going back to the Roman Empire, Augustus, just think of the name, and think of the idea of this empire bringing peace and stability to their people.
And now we're coming to the recitative number six and the aria for soprano number seven. Do you remember the sound? I played it at the beginning, in my few minutes. Very soft and sweet. Ja, ja, Gott ist uns noch mit seiner Hilfe nah. Contrasting the roaring aria of the bass. And then the music, perhaps you recognize it. In the Christmas oratorio, you've got the same music, but there it is. With oboe d'amore, with a big basso continuo, and erleuchte unsere finsteren Sinnen. The music is completely different, but it is the same invention, the same idea. And I think it's a really complicated business. Why did Bach use the same music for the Christmas oratorio and also for the soprano aria? Xoán, have you an idea what Bach was thinking, using afterwards this aria for the Christmas oratorio, which was written a few months later?
Could it be connected to Herodes?
That's an interesting question, Xoán. Yes, I think so, because Herodes is a dark side of a personality. And I think we've all got Herodes in us. And erleuchte unsere finsteren Sinnen, what does that mean in English?
Illuminate my dark side.
And see what is really great with this birth of baby Jesus. I think that might be an idea which is in the Weihnachtsoratorium. We will hear a little part of it. And in the aria, actually, it's somehow the same, because it's illuminating the defeat of the people in Danzig. The people in Danzig didn't want to be under the emperorship of August. Perhaps you could explain that to us, Xoán.
Well, absolutely, because this also shows the quality of Augustus being a hero, being able to forgive. So it's illuminating again one further aspect of this big emperor.
And in the aria, we haven't got a bass, we've got those very high voices, and the soprano sings, look, August, he could have killed them all in Danzig, but he didn't do that. His fine, warm-hearted feelings told him not to do that. And I think it's a great moment. It reminds me of the biblical love your enemies, which is such a difficult thing to do. I have an idea, Xoán. We could now listen to the aria of the Christmas oratorio with the bass, the oboe, and the basso continuo. And then afterwards, just listen to the aria with the soprano, the two flutes, the oboe, which sort of doubles the soprano, and the violetta with the violins.
Wonderful. And that way we will appreciate this parody technique that Bach has used here.
By the way, if you look at the screen, you see Anselm Hartinger.
Thank you.
That was the soprano. Now they all come together, the tenor, the bass and the soprano, even with the terzet and the whole orchestra. I had talked about it at the beginning, and then comes the choir. A lovely cantata with those nine pieces, rich, and I'm sure that August enjoyed it very much. What do you think about the whole story, Xoán?
Well, it's of course for us in the 21st century a bit difficult, you know, to imagine what was the mentality of all these people at the time. And there is a very interesting idea that Anselm said in the introductory workshop, coming on Bachipedia, by the way, which is the idea of state music. So, of course, this is a secular cantata as opposed to a church cantata. It's not music for the church. It's music for the outside world, so to speak, but it's state music made in a context of absolutism, in a context where authority was very important. This is a society, as Anselm says, that is imagined as a kind of household where the father, the boss of the family, is in command, commander-in-chief, and is telling you what you have to do in order to enjoy certain privileges and certain care. So state music, it's a very interesting idea. We have other examples in the course of history of state music beyond the Baroque era. But now I do have a little challenge for you just to finish our program today. And I would like you, Rudy, if you would agree, to improvise a little dance, a little suite, because this is music for a king, on the motif that you can pick from the initial choir, from the tenor aria that we listened, or from the final chorus which we didn't listen to, wherever you want.
Xoán, I feared that you would give me a last challenge, and I will take it, but I would love to take the last choir.
Very good.
Christmas Oratorium Merry Christmas, ladies and gentlemen.